But again, Steve, you don't see any preaching this morning. I'm excited. But first, do this. I already got disturbed once this morning because I had not silenced my phone. Take your phone, silence it, turn it off, something, so that it will not disturb our worship. That would be very much appreciated. If you're a first-time visitor, we'd love for you to have a record of your attendance. There's a table, you got a bump over it. Fill out a card, we'd love to acknowledge that you visited with us. I said in Bible class, Mike, I've got something for you. How's your wife doing?
Better.
Better? Okay. All right, but I've got something for you. You'll see me, and be patient. We said in a Bible class, if you are interested in some vegetables, they're kind of stirring around a little bit. So if you have issues, let me or Paul know. We'll see what we can round up for that. We are glad that you're here. Let's see. I said in Bible class, Psalm 118, verse 24, this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice in it. But this is also the day, the Lord's day, that we get together and worship. Celebrate his death, burial, and resurrection, and worship him. So we're glad to be here. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, and be glad in it, and be glad in it.
This is the day that the Lord has made, I will rejoice, and be glad in it.
This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made.
Out there or whatever. So if it comes out, then it's going to be dark. It just won't work. All against it.
Matthew says over and over again. And those three words are ready, watch, and hour. Now, I want you to remember the three words, ready, watch, and hour. Go back to Matthew 24, if you'd be so kind. I want you to read with me beginning at verse number 36. Well, the Bible says, but of that day and hour knoweth no man. Not the angels of heaven, but Jesus says, but my Father only. Drop down, if you'd be so kind, to verse number 42 of Matthew 24. Well, the first word there is watch. Therefore, for you know not what hour your Lord will come. But know this, that if the goodman of the house had known in what watch the thief would come, he would have watched and would not have suffered his house to be broken up. Therefore, be you also ready, for in such an hour as you think not the Son of Man coming. Drop down to verse number 50. The Lord of that servant shall come in a day when he looketh not for him, and in an hour that he is not aware of. Back in Matthew 25, now in verse number 10, and while he went to buy, the bridegroom came, and they that were ready went in with him to the marriage, and the door was shut. One more time in verse 13 of Matthew 25. Watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour wherein the Son of Man cometh. Now, we do not get the idea from Matthew's account that in a day and in an hour that none of us are aware of, that Jesus Christ is going to come back. Do you and I not get from Matthew's writing that there is a day that the Bible tells us that not even Jesus is aware of? There's a day and an hour that Jesus is going to come back for his bride, and I don't apologize for this, for his spiritual bride, the church of Christ, which there's only one of. Jesus is going to come back for his church. Brother Stevenson, when is Jesus going to come back for his spiritual bride, the church? When is he going to come back? Are y'all ready for the answer? I don't know. Point in fact, the scripture says that not even Jesus knows. And so since I don't know when he's coming back, since you don't know when he's coming back, since we don't know when Jesus is coming back, there are three things you and I need to be doing. The first thing we need to do is we need to get ourselves ready. The second thing we need to do is keep ourselves ready. So then number three, whenever Jesus comes back, we can be ready. Because whenever Jesus comes back, church, we're not going to have time to get ourselves ready. The only time we have is right now, while the blood is running warm in our veins. So what Jesus is doing in Matthew chapter 25, I want you to understand this. What Jesus is doing in Matthew 25, he's answering a question that his disciples posed to him in Matthew chapter 24. If you have your Bibles, I want you to go back to Matthew 24, and I want you to see the question that Jesus is answering in Matthew chapter 25. In Matthew 24 and verse number 3, here's the question Jesus is dealing with in Matthew 25. And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him privately, saying, tell us, when shall these things be, and what shall be the sign of your coming and the end of the world? That's the question that the disciples are asking Jesus. When they want to know, what is your coming back? Jesus, what is it going to be like? And what Jesus does in Matthew 25 is he tells a story that you and I call a parable. Jesus often spoke in parables. Now, you have to understand what parable is. Parable in the Greek language is simply parabole. Para simply is a word that means alongside of. It's where we get our words like paramedic. A paramedic, if someone is ailing or they're sick, a paramedic will come alongside and give them the medical attention that they need. A parachute. It aids a person in its fall. And so para simply means alongside of, but the word ball is a word that means to throw. So what Jesus does, he tells parables. A parable was a known story. It was something that the people Jesus spoke to, something that they knew, and he would throw it alongside something that they did not know. See, what is it that they don't know? They don't know what Jesus is coming back is going to be like. That's what they don't know. But what Jesus does, he throws what they don't know alongside something that they do know. And what is it that they know? They know how what it's like, or how Jews got married in his day. See, Matthew 25 is about the Jewish economy. It's about how Jews got married in his day. So Jesus says, my coming back is going to be like how Jews get married. See, you can't look at Matthew 25, how we get married in America today, because if you do, you miss everything that Jesus is talking about, because the Jewish economy had a different concept, a different culture of how they gave marriages. See, they had what was called a four-step process, and I want to go through that with you to help you understand what Jesus is dealing with here. See, the first step process under the Jewish economy was something called the engagement period. I want you to get this. The engagement period. The engagement period was when mom and dad, I want you to get this, they would go out and they would pick the young man, the young lady whom their son would marry. The parents did the choosing of who their son would marry. And that's not something foreign to the scriptures. If you're familiar with the scriptures, remember Samson? Remember Judges chapter 14, verse 1 and 2? What did Samson request of his parents? He requested of his parents in Judges chapter 14, and I'll read this. I'll just go back to the Old Testament. Some of you are taking notes, but I want to read this. Samson, back in Judges chapter 14, 1 and 2, he requested of his parents to go get him this Philistine woman. Judges 14, 1, and Samson went down to Timnath, and he saw a woman in Timnath, the daughter of the Philistines. He came up and told his father and his mother and said, I have seen a woman in Timnath, of the daughter of the Philistines. Now therefore give her for me to wife. Under that economy, what the parents would do, the parents would go out and they would have arranged marriages. Remember Isaac. Abraham commanded his servant to find a wife for his son Isaac back in Genesis chapter 24. So what happened was, it's called the engagement period. The kids could be downstairs in a bassinet, and the parents would meet together, and they would pick the young man or the young woman whom their child would marry. And what the parents would do under the Jewish economy, they would do two things. They would drink from a cup that's called a cup of commitment, and they would sign legal documents. Stay with me. And at that point, they would be considered married. See, understand, that's different than how you and I do it in the American economy today. See, our engagement is some young man meets some young woman, hormones jump up and down, able to ring on a finger. That's our engagement. But under the Jewish economy, the parents would pick the woman whom their son would marry. Some of you already know where I'm going with this. The church is not an afterthought in the mind of God. The church was not an afterthought. This is why the church is called the bride of Christ. Who planned that? His father. Who chose the bride? Jesus' father. And I'm here to tell you, Christ only has one bride. And everyone who's obeyed the gospel of Jesus Christ, you have to understand something. You are now what the Bible considers, what God considers, you are espoused or you are married to Christ. 2 Corinthians 11, verse 2. Paul, writing to the saints in Corinth, 2 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse number 2. 2 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse number 2. The church is called the bride of Jesus Christ. And those of us who obey the gospel of Jesus Christ, we are now what's called espoused, or we are married to Christ. Paul says 2 Corinthians 11 and verse number 2 of our Bibles. Excuse me, forgive me this. Second Corinthians 11, verse number 2, and First Corinthians. Look what he says here. He says, for I am jealous over you with a godly jealousy, right to the saints of Corinth, for I have espoused you to one husband, that I might present you as a chaste virgin to Christ. Now, remember, I said when the parents went and met the parents of the young lady that their son would marry, they did two things. They signed legal documents and they drank from a cup of commitment. Every child of God, every member of the body of Christ, you have to drink in the Spirit. When you got baptized, you drank in the Spirit. You committed yourself to be chaste to Christ, to divorce the world, to stop practicing sin, to live right, to do right, to act right, to worship right. You belong to Christ. We are espoused to Him. And so once they sign the legal documents, the parent, brother, the kids can be downstairs in the bassinet. Once the parents sign the legal documents, once they drink from a cup of commitment, it's what happened here. The young man goes back home with his parents. The young lady stays with her parents. This stage of the Jewish economy is what's called the interval period. It's called the interval period. And so what would happen during the interval period, if you have a man going to take care of business that he needed to take care of, but get this, the young lady would have to take care of the business she needed to take care of. And so she has to make arrangements for herself. I want you to get this. Make arrangements for herself. Change the way she's acting. Change the relationship she had with her family. Let them know, because I'm married and I am waiting on my bride. Where the church is right now as it relates to our relationship with Christ, if you obey the gospel, you need to understand we are in the interval period. Here's the scripture you always hear at the funeral, right? John chapter 14. Let not your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions, he says, for do not so I would have told you. What did Jesus say? So I go to prepare a place for you, that where I am, you may be also. So Jesus has gone away to prepare a place for his bride. He's gone away to prepare a place for us. And whenever the Father sends him back, he'll come to take his bride home to be with him, which is what the Bible describes as the marriage feast. Now, I want you to get this under the Jewish economy. The young lady, she never knew when her husband would come back for her. She never knew the day he would come back and say, I have everything ready. So you know what that meant? She had to get herself ready. She had to keep herself ready so that whenever he came back, she could be ready. She could be ready for the marriage feast. This is why Revelation 19 now. Revelation chapter 19 says this. Revelation chapter 19. I want you to turn there. And this is what every Christian is waiting for. We are waiting on the marriage feast. But until then, we are straightening out our business. We're getting our house in order. We're repenting of any sins we need to repent. We understand we belong to Christ. We need to be mending the relationships that are broken. You need to get bitterness out of your heart. Husbands need to be treating their wives like they need to treat their wives. Wives need to be submissive to their own husbands. Saints need to get rid of the backbiting and devouring one another. Need to get rid of all the anger and the animosity. Because if any of that is in your heart and you don't repent of it, understand something, heaven will not be your home. Let me say this, people do not go to hell because of sin. People go to hell because they don't repent of sin. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. People go to hell because you are not willing to repent of the things you have wrong in your life. And therefore, whenever that day comes, you'll be just like the parable Jesus talks about in Matthew 22. You'll find yourself speechless. The guy that came in without the wedding garment on, he was speechless. Why? Because the father under that economy, he provided the garments. During the wedding feast under the Jewish economy, the father provided everything that was needed for those who would participate in the wedding party. So no one would be out with an excuse on that day for not having on the proper garments. And so Revelation 19, this is what we're waiting on. In Revelation 19, in verse number 1 of our Bible, the Bible said, after these things, I heard a great voice of much people in heaven saying, Hallelujah! Salvation and glory and honor and power unto the Lord our God. For true and righteous are his judgments. For he had judged the great whore which did corrupt the earth with her fornication, and avenged the blood of his servants at her hand. And again they said, Hallelujah! And her smoke rose up forever and ever. And the 24 elders and the four beasts fell down and worshiped God that sat on the throne, saying, Amen, Hallelujah. And a voice came out of the throne, saying, Praise our God, all ye his servants, and ye that fear him, both small and great. And I heard, as it were, the voice of a great multitude, and as the voice of many waters, and as the voice of mighty thunder, saying, Hallelujah, for the Lord God omnipotent reigneth. Let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to him. Get this, verse 7. For the marriage of the Lamb is come, and his wife had made herself ready. Are you ready for the return of Christ? See, what's different between the way you and I get married in America and the way they got married in America? One of the main things is that in the Jewish economy, the center of attention is on the man. See, in our American wedding, the center of attention on a woman. See, when I got married, I knew what day I was going to get married. It was going to be May 24, 1997. I knew I was going to be there, and she was going to be there, and what day it was. We knew when to be ready. An American wedding, when I got married, me and the preacher came through from the side door with me and the best man. And there were people sitting in the audience just like you are. We came in, stood here just like I am. You know what the people did out there? Just what y'all are doing right now. Nothing. Thought I looked pretty good. Looked good. But all of a sudden, my wife was back there on dad's arm. She came through the door. And all of a sudden, everybody sitting down stood up and welcomed the bride. But when I came in, nothing. Why is that? Because there is no song, Here Comes the Groom. Because in an American way, the center of attention is on the wall. In the Jewish mirror, the center of attention is on a man. Our attention, your attention, if you remember the body of Christ, it must be on Amen. The groom.
Amen.
It's about Christ. It's about living for Christ. It's about doing what Christ has told and what Christ has commanded us to do. Christ is the head of the church. He should be always the center of our attention. And that's what Matthew 25 is teaching. Jesus is coming back. It's going to be like how Jews got married in his day. Four things, and I mean I'm done. Four things Matthew 25 teaches us. Number one, it teaches us, if you're going to be ready on that day, you must be ready every day. If you're going to be just being morally good is not good enough. I don't know how many times I hear, and saints, we've got to get this out of our spirit, that they're just good people. And they make it good. Well, my neighbor, she gives sugar when I ask. You know, they're not murdering anybody. They're kind. They wave. But good people don't go to heaven. Saved people do. All 10 are morally good. All 10 in Matthew 25 are virgins. And only 5 are getting it. Thirdly, Matthew 25 teaches us this, that salvation is non-transferable. Remember, the 5 asked, give us of your oil. The other 5 said, not so. You need to go buy for yourself. That means you can't be saved for your husband. You can't be saved for your wife. You can't be saved for your children. Everyone must be saved for themselves. You must work out your soul salvation with fear and with trembling. And lastly, this one's going to sting. Lastly, Matthew 25 teaches us this. Just being a member of the Church of Christ and not keeping oil in your lamp. Then you're not ready. See, many of us say, I'm a member of the church. I'm going through the 5 steps. So we come in and we sit on pews and we hide and we bury our talents. And somehow just think, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord. We're automatically in. Just being a member. Not getting busy in the kingdom of God through the Son will not get you into heaven. Let me say this. Baptism is just a start. Baptism is just the beginning. God, Jesus, expects you and I to be working. He's given you a talent. He's given you a gift. You need to be using that gift. Matthew 25 is all about, the first 13 verses is all about being prepared. 14 through 30 is all about being productive. He gives talents. The man with the one talent hid the talent. Why? He said, I don't get this. He was afraid. He was afraid and he hid his talent. Now let's just drop this in here. Fear has no place in the church. Fear and faith don't go in hand in hand. So for the brethren who close their doors for COVID, what I'm telling you, you need to get back to church. You need to get back to gathering. You need to stop being fearful. Stop worrying about being comfortable. And you need to get back to worship. You're to gather with the saints. We're to be together in one place. And if by some means you can't get here, guess what we'll do? The brethren will come to you and we'll worship, we'll gather in one place. And we'll go through the 5 acts of worship with you. But by no means is there any authority for TV worship, for watching it on TV, and the comfortability of your home, because you're not gathered with us. And I hope people get that in their spirit. There's no room for fear in the Lord's kingdom. So everyone who closes their doors, I hope we repent of it. Say, Lord, we're not going to do this anymore. Because when I read the Bible, there was death passing through the land in Exodus chapter 12. There's death passing through. The death angel, but you know what they're doing in their homes? They're worshiping. They're worshiping. COVID didn't take God by surprise. Pestilence doesn't take God by surprise. Nothing. He will take care of us. So just being a member of the Church of Christ is not enough if we're not keeping hold in our life. Are you ready? Are you ready for the return of Christ? If you're here this morning and you're not a member of the Church of Christ, you're not ready. You can't be ready until you sign your life to Jesus Christ. You've got to be born again. We've all seen it. And Jesus is still in the business of saving souls. He says, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I'm meek and I'm lowly at heart, and you'll find rest for your soul. For my yoke is easy. He says, and my burdens are light. You need to obey the gospel. You need to hear that Jesus died for you. You need to believe that he was buried for you. Be willing to repent of your sins. Repentance is a change of mind which leads to a change of action. We're not going to vote on you. We're not going to ask you what you've done. We're going to simply ask you, do you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God? Jesus said in Luke 13:3 and verse 5, until you name, unless you all likewise repent, you shall all likewise perish. And then upon your basis of repentance, you confess with your mouth, not your sins. You confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus. That's what Romans 10:9 teaches. So making that confession that you believe Jesus is Lord, you get baptized in water for the remission of your sins.
Amen.
Baptism is what puts you into Christ. It's in baptism, Jesus, who is alive, he baptizes you with the Holy Spirit. The individual gets in the water, he's saying, I believe Jesus died. I believe he was buried. I believe he rose from the dead. Simple, by that simple act of obedience, Acts 2:47, 3,000 people, they heard that message, and they believed. And they were added by the Lord to the one church, to the one people, to the one bride that you can read about in the Bible. Now, don't ever apologize. A whole lot of loose living women out there called religions and denominations, but Jesus has one, and she is the Church of Christ. I'm sure these brothers have got garments to change you into. You give us your hand, the Lord your heart. I'm sure they've got some water they can turn on, get you some water here if you want to be baptized and added by the Lord to the people of God. In here, and you are a Christian. You're not living right. You're not doing right. Maybe you're here saying, I'm not ready, Brother Stevens. I got some things I need some prayer about. I got some issues in my life I'm battling with. Maybe it's the sin of pornography. Maybe it's the sin of profanity. Maybe it's the sin of backbiting. Maybe you got some issues in your family with family members that you're not dealing with. Tell you something, brothers and sisters, you're not going to heaven unless you fix it. Ask God to help you fix it. And he'll help us. The song of invitation is what, brother?
Let
him
have his way.
Let him have his way. Let him have his way with you. It's a song of invitation. If you're here this morning, you're one that needs to be baptized, or you're a member of the body of Christ, and you desire prayers, don't let the devil stop you from doing what you know you need to do. Because we don't know the day or the hour. Are you ready? If not, will you come just now, even after we stand and sing?
Would Jesus and me always be very good? Would you walk with him within the narrow road? Would you have him very, very, very on your load? Let him have his way. Want to be his blood, we cleanse your heart.
we meeting tonight, 5:30 in the gathering place. It'll be a light meal of some sort, probably hot dogs. So we encourage you to be back. We'd like some fellowship and some encouragement. July 21st to the 24th, there will be a youth retreat. That'll be a journey farm in Grayville to encourage our young people. Jerry is out of pocket today. I'm not sure exactly where, but all of our kids need to make note of that and be involved in that. Next Saturday morning, July 23rd at 8 o'clock, we have men's prayer breakfast. And there's a sign-up sheet in the foyer. If you would like a biscuit, you need to sign that list or let me know. Otherwise, you need to get in line. And if there probably will be plenty. But anyway, let me know. Also on that same day, our ladies love out loud meeting at 10:30. That'll be in the gathering place. If you need to know what to bring, see Michelle Gorman for that. Then on Saturday, July 30th, will be our next caring and sharing distribution. That's clothing giveaway, food giveaway to those who are in need, and other items that we have on hand. The pantry's in pretty good shape, but if you would like to donate toward that, I'll pick the groceries up, make the check for the church, and earmark it for the pantry. There are Bible reading schedules on the table in the foyer, and it's also in the book in your bulletin. Please, change your life. Be a daily Bible reader. Change your life. That's encouraging. I was noticing on Facebook either last night or this morning it was a baptism for a work that we were involved in, Partners for Africa, Dorian Fleet, doing a wonderful work. And if I read it right, I think it was the 72nd baptism this year. And that's in South Africa. Well, I'm so thankful to be a part of that work. There's a container in the back for you to put your change. Remember that change. 50 cents will feed a man. Can't do that anywhere that I know of. So put some change in that container, some cash, some checks, whatever. Also, I've already said about the prayer list. Reminder about our sick and those that need prayer. Ray Townsend died earlier this week. That funeral, I'm pretty sure, is going to be on Thursday in Dixon, Kentucky. And several, I think, are going. If you have interest in that, you'll let me know about that. We may take the vein, I don't know. But anyway, let me know if you have interest in that. Don't forget Barbara London. She's under hospice care. Don't forget Bill and Freda Warner. Always a prayer. A car, some food. Don't forget Gene Mangrum. And prayers, please, for my wife who's struggling. She had eye surgery, had a detached retina on Monday. That's kind of an emergency type surgery. She's just not a lot better. So prayers for her would be appreciated. And then there's a list in the bulletin. And I would encourage you to take that bulletin with you. It's a tool for you to pray for those people